Hey guys, how's it going? Welcome back to another video here. Now in today's video, we are going to be determining the torque that we get at our wheels in our radio control vehicle using the gear ratio as well as the KV value within our radio control car. Now we do have a bunch of other information that we will need. We'll go through those steps. We do have five steps here on the board and we're gonna go through each one independently. And of these five steps, we do answer three questions that have come up in the comments section from other videos. Now, I certainly encourage you to go ahead and ask those questions in the comment section below if there's something about the video that isn't clear. I certainly make it a priority to try and get those questions answered first. So let's get started and talk about our data log. Now, this is the first area where you're going to have to get a little bit more information outside of the KV value as well as the gear ratio. This information comes from either your speed control or a standalone unit. What you want is a device that is able to measure that current output over time. This is what you see in our graph here, and it'll typically look like this. When you're racing around your radio control vehicle, you're accelerating and you draw a lot of current. And as you hit that peak speed, you may have to come up to a corner and slow down, which in case the current just drops off to almost nothing. And then it kind of settles, and then if you hit the throttle again, you're gonna get more current, you're gonna get another spike. And this sort of repeats itself. Now you can take a value anywhere on that curve, and you can determine what the torque output is. So in this case, I show you right here, this is the values that we have. This is what I took from a graph on a 1/8 scale buggy. And what we end up doing here is we're gonna go ahead and determine the max current from that, which is 71.3 amps. And we also look at the motor that we're using, and it happens to have 2,650 RPM per volt. That's our KV value that we use for this example. Now it's good to also know that this 1/8 scale buggy probably maxes out at around 70 kilometers an hour, which is somewhere in the neighborhood of 40 something miles an hour. So it's not that fast. It's actually one of the slowest vehicles that I have in that scale. So when we go and take a look at our next section here, which is our KT value. Now the way that we calculate our KT value is with this equation, where the KV value is equal to 1 over KT. If you simply rearrange this equation and throw KT on the left side and KV on the bottom here, you get KT is equal to 1 over KV. Now before we go and cover the rest of this, this was actually a question that I wanted to answer, is how do we go from 2,650 RPM to rads per second? So this is radians per second that we're trying to get. Well, one rotation or one revolution is equal to 2 pi rad. So that's how we're able to determine and convert this over. We go ahead and take our 2,650, we multiply it by 2 pi, and we get a value that we're able to convert based off of going from minutes to seconds. That's why we see this 60 here. So we take 2,650, multiply by 2 pi, and then we divide that by 60, and that gets us the radians per second. This is equal to 277.5 rad per second. We throw that into our equation. In fact, what you can do, you don't even need to go through any of these steps in order to make the conversion. Simply go onto Google, punch in the value of 2,650 revolutions, and convert that to rads per second. RPM to rads per second. You'll get the calculators, we'll spit these numbers out, and you don't need to go through any of this stuff and convert it yourself. So go ahead now and plug that into our formula where we get KT is equal to 1 over 277.5, and this is equal to 3.6, and keep a good note here, millinewton meters per amp. Now that's important because if you actually run this calculation, you're gonna get 0.0036. It's a very, very, very small number. So what I like to do is just round it out by multiplying it by 1,000 to get millinewton meters per amp. Now, for those of you who use the imperial system, KT is also equal to our 0.51 inch ounces or ounce inches, whatever you like to, however you like to say it, per amp. So that's what you get for the imperial system. Now it's interesting as we go through and talk a little bit more about that. So here we used our SI units in the metric system. I'm gonna continue from here on using the imperial system just so that we can see it in different ways. Again, it doesn't matter from here on in. What you do is you just take this number and you'd go ahead and multiply it through, and at the very end you'd get millinewton meters of torque output, or you'd get newton meters of torque output. It's identical from here. We're just using different numbers. We can manipulate this and turn it into any number that we wish to use. So let's go through now the gear ratio calculation. We talked about this in the last video that we did, and it's very similar here. In fact, it's the exact same. Our ratio is based off of our gear train, how it's laid out. This is the typical or conventional radio controlled gear system. It's made up of our pinion gear. This would be based off of the motor, and here it would be based off of the spur gear. Those are the mating gears from the motor to our first spur gear. From there, there's a shaft that connects that spur gear to the next pinion gear. If this happens, we know that we can multiply our two ratios. We're gonna get one ratio for this set, and we're getting another ratio for this set. Because gear B and gear C are locked on a shaft, they have to rotate at the exact same RPM. That's how we know we can multiply. From there, we can use the equation big gear over small gear, or in this case, B over A, and that's gonna be multiplied by our D over C. When we go ahead, throw all these numbers in, all these numbers are based off of the number of teeth on the gear. We use that because that is the best practice. I find it to be the easiest as well. We plug it in, 48 over 16 multiplied by our 43 over 11. This gives us a gear ratio of 11.72 to 1. What this tells us is that the pinion gear, we know that the big gear has to spin the least amount of times, the smallest gear has to spin the most amount of times, and we know that the direction of motion starts here and ends here. So this is gonna be our fastest moving gear, our second fastest moving gear, this one's tied for second place, and this is gonna be our slowest gear, so third, you know, in line. So this here, our motor is gonna have to spin 11.72 times in order to spin that last gear just once. That's important when we get back into our calculation down here. We'll cover that. The next thing that we want to look at is another question that did pop up in one of the videos. Now, what happens if your radio control vehicle does not have the conventional gearing setup based off of a drive shaft going from the center to the rear and front end of the vehicle? Well, this is why we're looking at this section here. If we do have a belt, and what we're gonna do here is ignore our blue gears in the middle here. So imagine this red shaft continues along the dotted line and then connects to our gear C down here. This means that this gear C and gear B travel at the exact same RPM. They're locked on the same shaft. So we have the same situation as this here, which does mean we can then again multiply the ratio that we get from here by the ratio that we get from our belt system. It doesn't matter that you have a belt here. You would take the teeth on the pulley as the count that you'd use here. You're gonna have 11 teeth on this pulley, and whatever the tooth count is on this, I only use 43 because we used it here, but if it was 43 on this pulley as well, we're gonna arrive at the exact same equation, which then produces the exact same ratio for us. So that's how you get that. Now let's take that ratio and move into the torque that we can get, as well as the torque at the wheels that we're gonna get. So first let's start at torque at the motor. The torque of the motor is equal to our KT value of the motor, and then we multiply that by IM. IM is represented by the current. It's a common form to represent current. It's known as I, and it's of the motor. This is back here where we cover the maximum current that we ended up pulling from the motor at that specific moment. Here we take our 0.51 ounce inches per amp and we multiply it by the 71.3 amps. We can cross off amps here on the numerator as well as the denominator, and we cancel out those terms, so we're left with ounce inches. Here we get 36.363 ounce inches, or we go and convert it to pound feet at 0.189 pound feet. Now I thought I'd throw that in there because in North America, what you get is a lot of the car manufacturers are only putting their values out specifically in this term, in these units. And it'd be nice to be able to compare them up against, you know, a full-size car and what that does. So then we go ahead, the next step from here is to jump into the torque at the wheels. Well, this again is quite simple. You only got three variables here, where the torque at the wheels now is equal to our gear ratio of the radio control vehicle multiplied by the torque of the motor. We worked out the torque of the motor in step four, and we did the gear ratio here in step three. We go ahead, plug those numbers in. 11.72, this is a gear ratio, it's unitless, it doesn't have units associated with it. We multiply it by 0.189 pound feet, and we get the torque at the wheels as 2.22 pound feet. Now, it's quite actually impressive to see that number. I know my actual full-size vehicle puts out about 120 pound-feet of torque at 7,800 RPM or so. And looking at this number, it's actually quite impressive that this smaller radio control vehicle that does not have anyone sitting within it actually is able to produce this amount of torque. And it's not even really a high-end system. This radio control vehicle is actually quite slow. Final question that we want to go through here is, what happens to the motor speed? Well, this is all dependent on our gear ratio. Now, when we consider gear ratios within our radio control vehicle, the gear ratio gives us a difference of two things. That first thing is the torque, and the second thing is the speed. If you increase one of those variables, the other one has to go in the opposite direction. So if one goes up, the other has to go down. Here, we're actually multiplying torque. Our torque value went and increased. It went from 0.189 to 2.2. So we got better amounts of torque out of it. That means that the speed that we get out of that motor at the wheels is reduced by that same proportion. We'd actually take the RPM that the motor is producing, we would divide that by 11.72, and we would get the output speed or RPM that we would expect out of the wheels. That's what's happening with the gear ratio in terms of your torque as well as the speed. Now, the last section that we have here is talking about what we're going to see in our next video. This is kind of a build up, the last video as well as this video, and everything that we're going to need in order to look at this specific topic. What we're going to be doing is we're going to take a brushless motor. We're going to maintain the same voltage, and we're also going to maintain the same physical motor size. We're going to look at one motor, and we're going to only change our gear ratio as well as our KV value. We're going to see exactly what happens to the torque output of that system. We're actually going to also look at what happens with the output speed. Well, the output speed is going to be maintained the same, and we're going to look at what's happening within our electric motors. That's the actual result we're looking for. What are we doing to those two electric motors from a theoretical perspective? So look forward to that video. Make sure you like the video if you do, and don't forget to hit that subscribe button so that I can see you in that next one. Thank you for watching.